from Acts 2:1-21 and Acts 1:8. You'll hear it throughout the message, but you pretty much know what Pentecost is about, don't most people here? Have an idea of what happened at Pentecost? You've heard the story in Sunday school, or if you've not been in Sunday school, about the disciples and the Holy Spirit descended, and they all talked in different languages and understood each other, and little flames of fire on their head. Huh? You know that the Holy Spirit happened. But I don't think that you understand what it's all about. We've heard that message so many times. I hear people say that. Some people will say in the church, you know, I just love the Spirit. I want to stop a minute. Vicki, I didn't see you there. We're praying for you, dear. How are you doing?
I'm better. I haven't worked out Thursday, but doing a lot better.
Pain is gone. Praise God. Amen. That's great. I didn't see you there. That is great. I figured you'd be removed and forgot you, so thank you. We are praying, and you are an answer to prayer. There's a lot of times that people will, in the church, will say, I just love the spirit of my church or this church. Or they'll say, you know, I wish this church was more alive. And yeah, really, it just doesn't seem to be much of a spirit. People say, you know, that's the pastor, the staff ought to be bringing this place to life. They ought to be doing it. Let me remind you of something, okay? The church is the ecclesia. The ecclesia, those who are called out to be. That's you. You want a spirit-filled church, you need spirit-filled people. That's what it takes. That's what we're trying to do, is get each other spirit-filled so we are alive and excited and we make a difference in the world for Jesus Christ and for people who don't know Him, so that we live out our faith as disciples instead of being lukewarm Christians, which we don't want to be, because Jesus said, I'll spit you out if you are. So it takes spirit-filled people. And we need to be filled and then fill others so that they can be fruitful, dynamic, powerful churches. That's what we ought to be. I'm excited. I love what I do. I love serving God with all my heart and soul. Even when it seems like it's nothing happening, I know that Holy Spirit power is available. And that's what it takes to get through for me too sometimes. Today is Pentecost Sunday. Today is the day we celebrate the beginning of the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the church of Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, you will receive power when I send the Holy Spirit. That's what happened on Pentecost. And guess what? It still happens today. And that's exactly what some people need. That's what the church needs around the world, but in the United States, and I'm telling you, in America, we need a Holy Spirit Pentecost moment. You need a Pentecost moment in your life if you're taking your faith in your church for granted. There's so many people who don't even have the ability to worship. Their churches are leveled. They're rubble. Man, all of a sudden, we want to go to church. I want to get involved. I'm going to help rebuild it. Well, let's start rebuilding from the inside out. The Holy Spirit happens inside. That's what we need. This country needs a Pentecost moment, and it needs it quick. Quick. A few weeks ago, I said there's two reasons to explain the disciples' radical transformation from being cowards and abandoning Jesus to being bold and courageous and willing to die for Him. And the first reason that happened to those first disciples was that they witnessed the risen Christ face to face. The second reason that it happened was that they experienced the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is where we get power to live the Christian life. After Jesus was raised from the dead on that first Easter morning, and before He ascended to heaven to go to prepare a place for us, is what He did. But He spent 40 days walking around and teaching and eating and fellowshipping with His disciples, hanging out. And among the final words He said was, go into all the world and preach the good news to all creation. That statement was one of the last things that He said to His followers. It's not the very last thing He said. And we're going to look at the words He spoke will hear the last words that he spoke, will hear on earth. And they are important words, absolutely essential to every believer to hear and heed, because, listen, without receiving the promise that Jesus gives his followers in this farewell statement, you cannot successfully live the Christian life without taking these words seriously. You know that after his death, his followers scattered. They abandoned him, like I said. Judas betrayed him, and then he took his own life. Peter denied him, said he never knew him. The others ran away, except for John. And then they locked themselves behind closed doors, like a bunch of wimps, to escape having the same thing happen to them that happened to Jesus. And they began thinking about how they might pick up the pieces of their lives again. What are we going to do? And they're wondering if they could ever one day make sense of all this that's just taken place. And then after having all but given up, beat down, beat up, tired out, fed up, the unthinkable happened. Mary, Magdalene, she came to them where they and said, I've just seen the Lord. He's alive. He's alive. Peter ran to the tomb to see for himself, and Jesus wasn't there. Peter wasn't quite convinced, and Luke tells us that in his gospel, he went away wondering to himself what happened. Luke went away like, what could have happened here? He's bewildered. And later that day, Jesus does appear. He appears to his disciples in the flesh. They hear him speak. They saw the scars. They ate fish with him. And they believed. They believed beyond all doubt that he was who he claimed to be. The Christ. The Messiah. The Son of God. Eventually, Jesus gave them what we know as the Great Commission. And I referred to it early. Go and make disciples and preach the good news to all creation. And in that mission statement, Jesus told his disciples that he was calling them to a task that certainly had to seem impossible. Can you imagine? He was telling this ragtag team of misfits, quitters, and underachievers to go out and change the world. Not just your street. Not just your neighborhood. Not just this side of town, the world. The world. Go out and change the world. Jesus knew. He knew it was a monumental task. And that these ill-equipped disciples were not ready for that task. He knew that they didn't have what it was going to take to pull it off on their own. They needed something more. Something more. And so after Jesus spoke about their new global mission that he had given them, he had one more thing to say to them. And they would be his last words that they would hear him speak out loud. Jesus is saying, more or less, in order for you to do what I'm asking you to do, you are going to need a blast. You're going to need a blast of dynamite. You need enough power that you can get beyond yourself and into the next level of living. And if you think it's impossible, he's saying, don't worry, I got you covered. Here's what he said to them. Part of it is captured in the final paragraphs of the Gospel of Luke, and part is in the first chapter of Acts. And Luke wrote both Luke and Acts, of course, so he says, I'm going to send to you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from up high. And then, in verse 4, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father has promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And then in verse 8, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes to you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to all the ends of the earth. the earth. Power. Power, he said. Clothed with power on high, you will receive power. That word, power, in the Greek, is dunamis. It's on your bulletin, dunamis. It's where we get the word dynamite. And that's the kind of power Jesus promised his followers and us. Dynamite. Back then and today. And so I want to talk to you about experiencing this power on high briefly today. And we need it. And we need to receive it. And we need to know how. So I want to point out a few things. And the first one I want you to see is that knowledge is not enough. It's not enough just to know the facts of the Christian faith. It's not enough to know just what the Bible says. It's not enough to be able to receive the Apostles' Creed and recite it during communion every time. Those things are good, but they're not enough. It's not enough to know Jesus Christ is Lord and that he is risen from the dead. It's a good thing to know. It's a necessary thing to know. It's certainly where you start, but merely knowing is not enough. If it were, you know what Jesus would have said to his disciples? Okay, look guys, you've been here with me 3 years. You heard my teaching. You've seen the miracles. You know what I can do. And now you've seen me raised from the dead. So, based on what you've seen, that should be enough for you. Knowing all that, would you please get going and go turn the world upside down? But that's not what Jesus said. That's not what he said, because he knew that merely knowing the facts in your head is not enough to get the job done. You need more than just knowledge to get through life. You need power, dunamis power, dynamite, dynamic, explosive, life-changing power is what I'm talking about. Without God's power, I'm going to tell you, life eventually unravels. Your lack of power, and your desperate need for power will eventually become obvious in your life. You may get away with it for a while, but it will catch up. That's what happened to the disciples. They discovered what they were truly capable of on their own. On their own, they were quitters. On their own, they were cowards. On their own, they were betrayers, abandoners, deniers. They came to the end of themselves until they knew the sin that they were capable of, and they knew the obedience they were incapable of. And they knew they needed something greater than themselves. It was obvious to them and everyone around them. And that's why Jesus says, you will be clothed with power from on high. Not one of them spoke up and said, no thanks, Lord, I'm good. I'll be fine without it. They knew that they needed it. Every follower of Jesus Christ eventually comes to that place, to the end of themselves, where in their desperation, and in their frustration, they must say, I can't do this on my own. I need power. Some get there quickly. For some, it takes decades of flopping around in their pain and misery to come to that realization. But everyone who is serious about being a disciple eventually comes to that place where they realize they can't do it on their own. And they need something more than what they have. They need power from above. Even the Apostle Paul fought this battle. Listen, in the book of Romans, he said, I don't understand what I do. For what I want to do, I don't do. But what I hate to do, I do. I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right here with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law. But I see this other law at work within me, waging war against the law. The law of my mind is making me a prisoner to the work within me, to his sin. He's wrestling with the same thing. He says, what a wretched man I am. Paul was experiencing the same powerlessness that the disciples experienced after the crucifixion. And that same powerlessness that we experience from time to time when we have a loved one in the hospital and we can't do anything, when we need that job, when we need that relief, when we need that bill paid, and we're powerless, powerless. We were created for the purpose to live in God, connected, in a relationship, and yes, even depending on God. When we try to live any other way, when we try to disconnect and live by our own power, we inevitably come to the end of ourselves. I have yet to see a credible exception. It happens to everyone. Without God's power in our lives, life unravels. That's the beginning. And we need to remember also that that power is available to every believer. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, he said. That's what Jesus promised to his disciples. And you know what? That's exactly what happened. That's what happened just a few days later on Pentecost. The disciples received power, and then some. After the day of Pentecost, do you realize what happened? There was an explosion of growth and salvation and baptisms and miracles and compassion and unity and holiness and healing. It was an incredible time. And it was the fulfillment of that promise that Jesus had made for his followers. That promise is yours. That promise is mine to receive. We all need it. And the good news is we can have it. The guidelines that Jesus gave his followers before his ascension are the same exact guidelines that we can follow today. And so in this time remaining here, I just want to talk to you what is involved in receiving dunamis, dynamite power. Not just power, but extra power from on high. Here's three principles, three caveats to keep in mind. First of all, wait. Waiting comes first. That's what Jesus told his followers. He said, stay in the city till you have been clothed with power from on high. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father has promised. I'm going to tell you, this runs very contrary to my way of thinking and my way of doing things. Okay, my attitude and my nature is, what do you mean wait? There's no time to wait. I need it now. I want it now. Why can't I have it now? Why can't I do that now? Why should I have to wait one more minute? Why? Why? Now get ready, because I'm about to say something very profound, believe it or not. We have to wait because we have to wait. It's God's way. I want you to understand something, though. Waiting on God is not the same as waiting on your spouse. When you're waiting on your spouse, it's typically because you're ready and you're waiting for him or her to get ready, and all they're doing is holding you up. That's not the way it is with God. When you're waiting on God, okay, listen, most often it's not because he isn't ready. It's because you aren't ready. So the time we spend waiting on God is time that we need to be spending on getting ready. We need to wait on God with one stipulation in mind. Waiting doesn't mean doing nothing. It means using your time to get ready for what God has in store for you. So while the disciples were waiting for the gift that the Father had promised, they didn't spend their time doing nothing. What'd they do? They took care of some business. They chose an apostle to take Judas' place. And they spent their time in prayer. And they spent their time in worship and fellowship with one another. They spent their time seeking God. That's the only way, my friends, to wait. In fact, you should consider those two things synonymous. Waiting on God and seeking God. They go hand in hand. And I want you to know, listen, waiting on God always pays off. Psalm 27:14. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. And then in Isaiah 40 and verse 31, but they who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not be weary. And they will walk and not faint. Waiting pays off when you're waiting and seeking the Lord at the same time. If you find yourself in a situation right now where you have come to the end of yourself and you know that you need a blast of spiritual dynamite in order to move to the next level, here's what you need to do. Wait on God and seek him while you wait. While you wait, spend your time doing what you can do to get ready. If you've got some unfinished business to wrap up, wrap it up. If there are some steps you can take to get further ready, take those steps. Do everything you can to make yourself ready and put yourself in that position to receive that power from on high. And during this time, seek God. Did I mention that? Seek God while you wait. God's power is on the way. It's on the way. It will arrive when you are ready. So how do you know? How do you know? Believe me. You will know when God's power arrives. Some of you have experienced it in your lives. Sometimes you see it in the circumstances around you. God will begin to cause things to happen that you know is only from God. There's no doubt about it. God has arrived and is calling you now to move forward. Sometimes you feel it in your spirit. You'll sense it. I've said more times than I can count that we don't live by our feelings. And that's always going to be true. But at the same time, there are times when God's Spirit moves in your life so powerfully and you know it's happening because you feel it. I can feel it. Waves of joy and love and peace and confidence and certainty and compassion and purpose. I recently heard a story about Michael Morton, who was wrongfully convicted in Texas of murdering his wife by a corrupt police force and a dishonest district attorney. For 2 decades, 20 years, he languished in prison, losing appeal after appeal. Even though the evidence existed that would overturn his conviction, the DA kept blocking it, and the courts refused to consider it. One day, after yet another legal disappointment, he came to the end of the road and he cried out in desperation, God, please help me. I have nothing left. Well, nothing happened that day. But one night, a few weeks later, he was getting ready to go to sleep, and he put on his headphones so that the music would drown out the prison sounds around him. And suddenly, he was clothed with power from on high. In his words, he said, "God bathed me in light." From that day on, he was a changed man. He was a free man. Even though he remained incarcerated for 6 more years. Finally, even though the district attorney did everything he could to prevent withheld evidence from being properly tested, it was tested. And Michael Morton was exonerated and released from prison. And today, he will tell you, "I was released from prison in June 2011. But I was set free 6 years earlier when I had a personal encounter with Jesus Christ, and I was clothed with power from on high." When God's power arrives, you will know it. You will see it in the circumstances around you, you will sense it in your spirit, and you will also see it in the results, in the aftermath. The results you begin to experience won't be what they used to be. Seek God's power in everything you do. The results, you will see it. You'll see it. Now here's a warning. Receiving God's power doesn't mean that God does everything and you do nothing. If I'm going to tell you, if we were to win 100 people to Christ in the next year, it's not going to be because God randomly sends people in here while we sit back and wait for God to fill this room. We still have to put forth an effort. We still have to be doing the work. But the difference is that God is now powering the engine. Sometimes that work is challenging, exhausting, late nights, long hours, and all the determination that you can muster. But the difference is that you're doing it with God's blessing on your efforts. It's the same in your personal life. Experiencing God's power doesn't mean that you sit around and wait for God to do it all. We are good at that. It means that you do what you can and let Him work through you. Here's the last thing I want to talk about, Dunamis. God's power is always related to God's purpose for your life. God's power is always related to God's purpose for your life. Jesus said again, "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to all the ends of the earth." You see, God wants to use you in such a way that others will see His glory in you. Yeah, little old you. God wants to use you so others will see His glory. He wants to use you in such a way that your life is a testimony to His greatness and His goodness and His mercy and His compassion and His overwhelming love. He wants to use you so that that can be seen in your life. When you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you became a citizen of the kingdom of heaven. And God's purpose for you is that you become a productive citizen. In your work, in your relationships, in your activities, everything you do should be about furthering the kingdom of God. And that means that in your work, in your relationships, in your activities, you are touching and ministering to others in the name of Jesus. That may be in your family, it may be in your workplace, it may be in your church. There is a stipulation to keep in mind with this one too. God's power is not just for you. It is for the benefit of others. You will be clothed with power on high so that your life will have meaning and purpose, and that purpose is to be a blessing for other people. Here's what it comes down to. God's plan for you as an individual and for all of us together as a church is really way too big for us to imagine. It is, and it seems impossible. Some of you may be thinking right now, me? Me? Change the world? I could barely get in this morning. How can we as a church expand our ministry when we're barely making ends meet as it is? How is it possible? How? It is only possible, through the power of the Holy Spirit. It is only possible with dynamite, dunamis, power. If you need more of God's power in your life, then you need to decide today that you will seek Him and you will wait expectantly and prepare yourself in every possible way so that you're in a position for Him to move in your life. And move, God will. God will move. God can and will change the circumstances around you. God will change the circumstances within you. And God will pour out blessing on your efforts. God's power makes all the difference. All the difference in the way we live our lives. When we try to live on our own power, we're like an engine that's running low on oil, knocking around everywhere we go. But when we are filled with God's power from on high, our lives run like a well-oiled machine. Now, it won't be problem-free. No, it won't be pain-free, but filled with power nonetheless. He can do immeasurably. That means you can't measure more than we ask or imagine if we will allow His power to work within us. Now, if we have this dynamite power in us, do you have it in you? Then I want to ask you, is it working efficiently? If our pipes, so to speak, are clogged with the sin of whatever kind, then that is like a sludge that contaminates His presence, and His power will not flow. What's keeping it from flowing in your life? We must be cleansed and filled with God's holiness for His miracle working power to operate in us. Get the sludge out. As I prepared this message, I wondered and I asked myself, and I invite you now to ask yourselves, is His dynamite power efficiently working through me? Really? What works go undone? What wounds of others go unattended? What heartaches of others go uncomforted? What needs of others go unmet because I do not listen to the Lord's leading, to Him leading me, or because I'm hiding some sin? And in doing so, I don't allow God's power to work through me. When Jesus sent His disciples out, He gave them dunamis power and authority over demons to preach the kingdom and to heal the sick. That same power and delegated influence has been given to us, if Christ lives in us. It's been given, that same power, given to us if Christ lives in us. Isn't that an awesome thought? If we are the dwelling place of God in the Spirit, then His living power and energy resides in us, working as we agree to accomplish His work. Oh, if only we could grasp the magnitude of His dynamite power. And only if we allowed Him full reign in our hearts, how much immeasurably more He could do and we could do for the Lord. As a disciple of Jesus Christ, you cannot make your mark on the world until God makes His mark on you. And this is how God does it, through the power of the Holy Spirit. And here's the challenge for this week, for those of you who are up to it. Ask God to fill you with the power of the Holy Spirit so that you can make a difference in the lives of other people and that you can experience the power you need because you can't do it on your own. Ask Him for dunamis, dynamite, to explode in your life and in your heart. In Jesus' name, let's pray. Lord, we are yours to command. I ask that you would cleanse us of all that hinders us and hinders the flow of your love, your spirit, and your dynamite power. Jesus, work your will in me and in us, that we may bring glory to your name and that we may be a reflection of your mighty power, love, and grace for others. It's in your name we ask it. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.